Dear students, welcome to Gnana Diksha Concept Based Digital Learning. I am Dr. K. Srilata, lecturer in Zoology from Telangana Social Welfare Residential Armed Forces Preparatory Degree College for Women, Bongir. Before going to the topic, what you are seeing in this picture? The endocrine system of a person, right? This is responsible for regulating a range of bodily function through the release of hormone. The endocrine system and the release of hormones will maintain the homeostasis of the body. Let us take a quick look at the learning objectives of today's topic. By the end of this session, you will learn about the hormone receptors. You will understand the mode of action of hydrophilic hormones. You will be able to understand the mechanism of lipophilic hormones. You will know the concept of secondary messengers. You will understand how hormones induce changes in cellular metabolism. Let us understand what is signal transduction using this image. In multicellular organisms, the cells receive a variety of signals from different sources, including endocrine glands, and they respond appropriately. Animal cells exchange information about the concentration of ions and glucose in extracellular fluids. The interdependent metabolic activities taking place in different tissues and the correct placement of cells during embryonic development. In all these cases, the signal represents information that is detected by specific receptors and converted into cellular response, which always involves a chemical process. The conversion of this external information in the form of a signal into the metabolic or physiologic change in the cells is called signal transduction. These are some signals to which the cells respond. The light will induce the production of antigens. The mechanical touch will sensitize the cell surface glycoproteins or oligosaccharides. And nutrients will induce the developmental signals. The extracellular matrix or two odorants. What are odorants? These are the chemical compounds that are having a smell or odor. The pheromones act on growth factors. And again, one more term, what is a pheromone? Pheromones are the chemicals. They are capable of acting like hormones, but outside the body of the secreting individual to impact the behavior of the receiving individuals. That is what pheromone is. And tastants are the taste provoking chemical molecules that are dissolved in ingested liquids or saliva. This tastants stimulate the sense of taste. Let us now define the term hormone. What is a hormone? A hormone is a chemical regulatory substance which is secreted by ductless glands. Ductless glands are nothing but endocrine glands. These are the natural organic substances, and they will regulate the growth, metabolism, and other functions of an organism. These are simply biochemical messengers. It passes through the bloodstream to reach the tissues on which it acts. These tissues are called target tissues. The target tissue of a certain hormone is the tissue which contains the specific receptors of that hormone only. The hormones classified according to the chemical composition, organs where they work. For example, reproductive hormones in the reproductive organ. Let us see the general functions of hormones. Hormones will regulate the different metabolic pathways. They coordinate the activities of different organs of the body. And some hormones, they control the rate and type of growth of body. What are the general characteristics of hormones? They are not secreted at a uniform rate. They exert their effects in biocatalytic amounts. Their turnover is varied and usually rapid. They exert multiple actions and they exhibit high degree of specificity. Different tissues may respond differently to a given hormone. These are the general characteristics of hormones. Coming to the general principles of hormone action. The first one is the tropic hormone. What it is? a hormone that is having a primary function that regulate the hormone secretion by another endocrine gland. And the second one is synergism. When different hormones work together and have a greater effect than the individual hormone action, that is called synergism. What is permissiveness? A small amount of one hormone allows a second hormone to have its full effect on a target cell. That is, the first hormone permits the full action of the second hormone. What is antagonism? In the name itself, you can understand. Anta means opposite. One hormone produces the opposite effect of the other. For example, the process involved in both negative and positive feedback. For example, if A is greater than B, greater than C, greater than D, what is the final product? D. What is the initial one or substrate? That is A. A gives rise to B, B gives rise to C, C gives rise to D. If the concentration of D increases, it will inhibit the A, that is negative feedback. If the D is decreases, the A production is triggered, that is positive feedback. Let us see what are hormonal receptors. Hormones act as signal molecules and they carry specific messages to the target cells and direct them to perform a specific task. They convey the messages to the cells by binding to specific receptors. Hormones produces their effects on the target tissues by binding to specific proteins called hormone receptors located in the target tissues only. So where does these receptors are located? They are located on the target tissue or within the target tissue. Let us define the term the hormonal receptor. It is a cell associated recognition molecule which are generally proteinaceous in nature. And it consists of two sites. One is a recognition site where the hormone will specifically bind to it, and another one is the signaling site. It couples hormone binding to the intracellular effect. The picture is showing the intracellular receptors. They are located in the cytosol or the nucleus. The receptors present in the cytoplasm or nucleus are called intracellular receptors, and mostly the intracellular receptors are nuclear receptors. For example, the steroid hormones, which are hydrophobic in nature, they bind to intracellular receptors. Coming to the second type of receptors, as you are seeing in the picture, they are cell membrane receptors or membrane bound receptors. They are attached to the surface of the cell. They are hydrophilic in nature and the protein hormones bind to cell surface receptors. As the plasma membrane is lipoproteinaceous in nature, the molecules which are hydrophilic in nature, they cannot cross the plasma membrane. So the proteins or peptide hormones or catecholamines, they cannot cross the plasma membrane. So they will attach to the cell surface. So they are called hydrophilic hormones. Now second one, that is lipophilic hormone. They are poorly soluble in water. So they cannot be dissolved in watery blood. They bind to plasma protein and present in the blood in protein bound form. They are lipid soluble. The lipid soluble hormones include thyroid hormones, steroid hormones and vitamin D3. They are synthesized from the cholesterol. So these steroid hormones are lipophilic in nature. As they are soluble in lipids, they can cross the plasma membrane and they will interact with the receptors inside the cytoplasm or the nucleus. Hormones are classified into two groups based on their receptors. If the receptors are present intracellularly, they are called group 1 receptors, nothing but steroid hormone receptors. If the receptors are present on the cell membrane and mechanism through the secondary messenger, these hormones belong to group 2. What is the solubility of group 1 and group 2? Group 1 hormones, they are soluble in lipids. They are not soluble in water. So they are called lipophilic hormones, and group 2 hormones are hydrophilic in nature. And for the transport of these group 1 hormones, they require a transport protein or carrier. And for the group 2 hormones, they don't require any transport protein. And the half-life of these group 1 hormones is long, from hours to days. And the half-life of group 2 hormones is short, in minutes. And what are the receptor mediators? And these group 1 hormones, they will show the response, biological response, by the formation of a receptor hormone complex inside the cell. Whereas group 2 hormones, they are not directly binding to the target cell. They need secondary messenger to convey the signal, and they will induce the synthesis of proteins. And these secondary messengers, like the examples, cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, calcium, DAG, that is diacylglycerol, kinases, phosphatases, and all these are acting as a secondary messengers. The group 1 steroid hormones, they are derived from the cholesterol, as I told you. They include glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids, sex hormones, thyroid hormones, and retinoic acid. The last two, those are thyroid hormones, T3 and T4, and retinoic acid, they act on intranuclear receptors. The receptors for these hormones are located within the nucleus. The hormones such as adrenaline, somatostatin, parathyroid hormone, pituitary hormones such as ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, LH, luteinizing hormone, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, HCG, human chorionic gonadotropin, and alpha-2 adrenergic catecholamines and beta-adrenergic catecholamines, these all mediate the response by secondary messenger, that is CAMP, cyclic adenosine monophosphate. And the second one is CGMP, cyclic guanosine monophosphate. The examples are NO, nitric oxide, and ANF, atrial natriuretic factor. The third one, CA+2-RPI, phosphatidyl inositol. The hormones like oxytocin, gonadotropin releasing hormone, GnRH, gastrin, cholecystokinin, TRH, thyrotropin releasing hormone, substance P, PDGF, platelet derived growth factor, muscarinic acetylcholine, alpha-1 adrenergic catecholamines, these all react or undergo the pathways releasing secondary messengers such as calcium and phosphatidyl inositol. And the fourth one, important one, through the mediation of kinases or phosphatases. The examples are growth hormone, EGF, epidermal growth factor, prolactin, and very important, that is insulin. The sequence of events that are seen by group 1 hormones. First of all, the hormone or ligand, it will interact or it will bind with the receptor and form a hormone receptor complex. The binding of hormone receptor complex occurs to hormone receptor element. In the second step, the hormone receptor complex will bind to a hormone receptor element. This is located on the DNA. This complex, the hormone receptor complex to the hormone receptor element, they further activate the factors which are called transcription factors that are present beside this hormone receptor element will get activated, and they will stimulate the transcription process, and in turn will synthesize the proteins. And these activated proteins or synthesized proteins get expressed and show the biochemical response. So this is the sequence of events that you will see in group 1 hormones. Now coming to the group 2 hormones, these hormones, they will bind to the cell surface receptors as they cannot cross the plasma membrane, and they will activate the G protein that is located in the plasma membrane, and further the activated G protein will activate protein kinases, and these kinases, they will phosphorylate the protein and form a phosphoprotein, and this phosphoprotein will further show the biochemical effect. As we are discussing many times, so the secondary messengers, what they will do? What is the relation between the hormones and the secondary messengers? Let us know. Coordination is the process through which two or more organs interact and complement the function of one another. Coordination is brought either by the nervous system or by the endocrine system through their secretions. The secondary messengers are the chemical molecules that relay signals received at receptors on the cell surface, such as arrival of the protein hormones or growth factors, etc., to the target molecules in the cytosol or in the nucleus. The secondary messengers, in addition to their job as relay molecules, the secondary messengers serve to greatly amplify the strength of the signal. They will also amplify the signal and causing the some kind of change in the activity of the cell. Al Wilbur Sutherland Jr. is the scientist who discovered these secondary messengers, for which he won the 1971 Nobel Prize in Medicine. The secondary messenger may be a cyclic adenosine monophosphate, as we have already listed out some secondary messengers. Yeah, first one, that is cyclic AMP or 3,5 cyclic adenosine monophosphate. It is a secondary messenger important in many biological process. CAMP is a derivative of adenosine triphosphate. It is formed from the ATP. ATP gives rise to cyclic AMP by the enzyme adenylate cyclase. And it is used for the intracellular signal transduction in many different organisms, conveying the CAMP dependent pathway. When the hormone combines with the receptor on the target cell, the level of cyclic AMP in the cell is increased by the activation of the enzyme adenyl cyclase, which converts ATP to cyclic AMP. The cyclic AMP will initiate the chain of reactions. This is called cascade mechanism. The one will convert the other and the other will activate the other. So in this way, the cascade mechanism will continue. In some cases, cyclic AMP affects the activity of specific genes so that the particular protein is synthesized. If the target is another endocrine gland, the cyclic AMP regulates the secretion of its hormones. In that way, the cyclic AMP will act as a secondary messenger. Now, the second one is cyclic guanosine monophosphate or CGMP or guanosine 3'5' monophosphate. It is also a cyclic nucleotide like CAMP and it is derived from GTP. As we have seen, CAMP from the ATP, here CGMP from the GTP, that is guanosine triphosphate, and the enzyme required is guanylyl cyclase. There, that is adenylyl cyclase, here guanylyl cyclase, and here you need a stimulator, that is nitric oxide. CGMP acts as a secondary messenger much like the cyclic AMP, that is activation further by kinases. And the third one is Ca plus 2 or phosphoinositol or both. And the fourth one is protein kinases or phosphatase cascade mechanism. The hormone, importantly, the hormone is considered to be the first messenger. Till now we are discussing about the secondary messengers. Okay, we may get a question that then what is the first messenger? The hormone is the first messenger. Let me give an example for this. I want to send a letter or I want to give some information to a person where he is in the other place. I cannot go now due to some situations. What I will do? I will make a phone call or I will make some text message or I can send some information through some other means. Okay. So here, what I want to send a message? I am a hormone and in between I am using what? I am using my mobile or phone, that is a secondary messenger. I think you got an idea. Now, hormone receptor interaction. Each receptor is specific to one hormone only and hence receptors are specific that hormone. A molecule which binds to a receptor is called a ligand. After binding to a receptor, it causes some conformational changes in the receptor and form a receptor ligand complex. A ligand may be a peptide or a neurotransmitter, or it may be a hormone. For instance, take an example, insulin. It will bind to the insulin receptors, which are present on the hepatocytes, that are liver cells, or adipocytes, or some skeletal muscle cells. While the epinephrine will bind to the beta adrenergic receptors, which are present on hepatocytes. These receptors may be divided into four families. First one is ligand gated ion channels, G protein coupled receptors, enzyme linked receptors, and intracellular receptors. See the diagram here. Coming to the first receptor family, comprises ligand gated ion channels. They are responsible for the regulation of flow of ions across the cell membranes, for example, synaptic transmission. The second family of receptors consists of G protein coupled receptors. These receptors are comprised of a single peptide that has 7 membrane spanning regions. That means the protein is having 7 helices, and these receptors are linked to a G protein. And this G protein is having 3 subunits, alpha, beta, and gamma subunit. And to the alpha subunit, the GTP will get bind. The third major family of receptors consists of having cytosolic enzyme activity as an integral component of their structure or function. The most common enzyme linked receptors are of epidermal growth factor, platelet derived growth factor, atrial natriuretic peptide, insulin, etc. They have this tyrosine kinase activity as part of their structure. The fourth family of receptors differs considerably from the other three in that the receptor entirely intracellular, and therefore the ligand or the hormone, they must diffuse through the plasma membrane to the cell to interact with the receptor, for example, steroid hormones. The heterotrimeric G protein discovered by Alfred Gilman and Martin Rodbell in 1990. You are seeing those scientist pictures here. Coming to the G protein. The G proteins, also known as guanine nucleotide binding proteins, are a family of proteins that act as molecular switches inside the cells and are involved in the transmission of signals from a variety of stimuli outside a cell to its interior. Their activity is regulated by factors that control their ability to bind to and hydrolyze the GTP, guanosine triphosphate, to GDP, guanosine diphosphate. When they bound to the GTP, they are on, and when they are bound to the GDP, they are off. The heterotrimeric G proteins located within the cell are activated by G protein coupled receptors, GPCRs, that span the cell membrane. The signaling molecules bind to a domain of the GPCR located outside the cell, and an intracellular GPCR domain then in turn activates a particular G protein. Now coming to the concept of mechanism of lipid soluble hormones. How the lipid soluble hormones work? They work by binding to a specific cell receptor in the cell membrane and form the hormone cell receptor complex, and then which diffuses into the nucleus. The receptor is eventually released for the reuse. The steroid will activate the specific gene of the hormone receptor element and produce the mRNA. This mRNA now comes out of the nucleus, they pass into the cytoplasm, and it will initiate the protein or enzyme synthesis. And how these process occur step by step, we will see. In the first step, the free lipophilic hormones not bound with plasma protein carrier, they diffuse through the plasma membrane of the target cell and binds with the receptor, which is located intracellularly in the cytoplasm or nucleus. In the next step, each receptor has specific binding region, as we have already discussed, with the hormone, and another region with the binding with the DNA. The receptor alone cannot bind to the DNA unless it binds to the hormone. Once the hormone is bound to the hormone receptor complex binds to a specific region of DNA that is known as hormone response element, HRE. And from the DNA, now the formation of mRNA occurs. This mRNA transported out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm, and the formed mRNA. Now in the cytoplasm it get converted into a polypeptide with the help of ribosomes that are present in the cytoplasm, and which is called translation or protein synthesis. And the formed protein or enzyme released from the ribosome will convert it to a functional protein, and it ultimately shows the effect or response. Now coming to the other group of hormones, so that is water soluble hormones. They will mediate the action by secondary messengers. So the first messenger or the hormone or the ligand that diffuses from the blood through the interstitial fluid then binds to its receptor at the exterior surface of the target cell, as they cannot cross the plasma membrane. Now the hormone receptor complex is formed, and they will activate the G protein that is located in the plasma membrane. The activated G protein in turn activate the adenylate cyclase. If it is a CAMP mediated pathway, it will activate the cyclic AMP. If it is a CGMP mediated pathway, it will activate the CGMP. Now further, these enzymes will activate the protein kinases, and the activated protein kinases will phosphorylate the one or more cellular proteins. Phosphorylation means addition of a phosphate group to a protein. The phosphorylation activates some of these proteins and inactivate others, rather like turning a switch on or off. Phosphorylation of protein in turn cause reactions that produce physiological responses. In the same way, the effector for the CGMP is guanyl cyclase, and the mechanism is same as that of adenylate cyclase. Coming to the third class in group 2, that is mediation by Ca plus 2 or phosphatidyl inositol mechanism of action. The hormone will interact with the receptor, and this form a hormone receptor complex, and further it will activate the G protein. Okay, and the G protein also increases the movement of calcium ions, and this G protein in turn activate the phospholipase C, which is a effector molecule present in the plasma membrane, and this effector molecule will convert the PIP2 phosphatidyl inositol diphosphate into two molecules. Those are DAG and IP3, diacyl glycerol and inositol triphosphate. DAG activated phosphokinase, and IP3 induces the release of calcium from the SER, that is smooth endoplasmic reticulum. What happens? The DAG activated the phosphokinases further, and the formed IP3 will induce the release of calcium from SER. Now this calcium attaches to the calmodulin and form a complex. This calcium calmodulin in turn activate further the kinases. The conversion of protein into phosphoprotein occurs by the direct action of phospholipase C, or by the action of calcium calmodulin complex, or by the action of DAG, and this will further show its effect or responses. The examples that you have remembered for this third category are oxytocin, vasopressin, substance P, and muscarinic acetylcholine, etc. Coming to the last group, that is group D of group 2 hormones. These are kinases or phosphatases. They form a cascade chain of mechanism. The very important example that we are taking is insulin. Insulin is attached to the receptor and causes the phosphorylation and the activation of the intracellular tyrosine molecule. Okay, as already we have discussed in the receptors concept, they are having intracellular tyrosine molecules, and these tyrosine molecules will get phosphorylated, and these they further activates the insulin receptors 1 to 4, and this further activate the various kinases, which finally shows the biological effects by subsequent transcription and translation reactions, and shows the biological activity. Coming to the feedback control mechanisms, there are two kinds of feedback we will see: negative and positive feedback control. The negative feedback control occurs when the original effect of the stimulus is reduced by the output. The negative feedback mechanism then normalizes the things when they start becoming too extreme. For example, the thyroid gland is regulated by negative feedback mechanism. When the thyroid levels are increased, the hormone stops secretion of TRH by the hypothalamus and the secretion of TSH by the pituitary gland. That is a negative feedback mechanism. The positive feedback mechanism, when it works, it occurs when the original effect of the stimulus is enhanced by the output. The condition become extremes in this mechanism also. Steroid hormones increase cellular activity by binding to DNA and forming a gene hormone complex. Second question, the hormone response element is located on DNA. Third one, the binding of hydrophilic hormones lead to the activation of secondary messengers. Fourth one, water soluble hormones exhibit the shortest half-life than the lipophilic hormones. Last one, DASH is a calcium binding protein. Calmodulin is a calcium binding protein. Students, I want to give an activity based on the discussed topic. Understand and list out the various mechanisms of hormone action. The second one, write the sequence of steps involved in the mechanism of protein hormones and prepare a chart on hormones classification. Thank you.